often force ourselves to be me-centeredness and material-centeredness, success-centeredness in our life, right? However, as a child of God, is it okay to live like that, right? That's something, some question that I have, because I was just keep digesting the words that it was given to us last week, the true peace, right? And the true peace, with the true peace, something that what God has given to us, right? And why do we have to have assurance in our life, right? It's because we are different life. We have a different life, right? We're a different being, right? So in order for me to have assurance in my life, I realized that, wait, I need to accept God's absolute sovereignty in my daily life, right? So I want us to take a look at what is God's sovereignty today. So I try to look it up in our definition, and Jean Bodin, he's a French politician, I think, and he's one of the French people that wrote a lot of books, right? But one of his books, he wrote this quote. It says that sovereignty is the absolute and perpetual power, right? So when we talk about sovereignty, this is power that absolute, and we absolutely obey to it. We absolutely just fall into it, and we just carry by it, right? And sometimes this sovereignty, right, amaze each people, right, and inspire each people, right? Because this sovereignty is something that change all things, right? And sovereignty has three important elements. These three elements define sovereignty: territory, people, and the strong belief that unites them. So these are the elements that make up the sovereignty. So when we accept God's absolute sovereignty, what do we have to accept? What do we have to enjoy in our life? As children of God, we must ensure that God's sovereignty is exercised in this world, right? We are called to protect His territory, guard ourselves as His people from worldly temptation and desires, and maintaining a strong conviction in our faith so that we are not carried away with this worldly spiritual influence, right? The world is trying to influence with this evil content, right? So these are the things that we have to be careful of. And we, as accept God's absolute sovereignty, we must do these things and follow these things so that we can, like how David confessed in 1 Chronicles, right? As we read it together, right? And I think it would be better if we can read it together. And once again, like how David praised God, right, before the assembly, acknowledging God as the ultimate ruler and giver of all things. And I want us to read this scripture one more time, right? 1 Chronicles chapter 29, verse 10 through 14. And we must declare our King every day in our life and be able to really praise Him, because He holds the absolute sovereignty in our life. So at this time, we're going to read it together. If the screen comes up, and I want us to read it together because this is worship, right? Let's read it together to praise God. Let's read it. Therefore, David blessed the Lord in the presence of all the assembly, and David said, "Blessed are you, O Lord, the God of Israel, our Father, forever and ever. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty, for all that is in the heavens and the earth is yours. Yours is a kingdom, O Lord. You are exalted as head above all. Both riches and honor come from you, and you rule over all. In your hand are power and might, and in your hand it is to make great and to give strength to all. And now we thank you, our God, and praise your glorious name. But who am I, And what is my people that we should be able thus to offer willingly? For all things come from you, and all of your own have we given you. Amen. And we want to really confess it every day, right? However, we fall into, if you don't do that, right? And if it's just not, we don't do that, right? And I want us to take a look at what people around us are going through, right? I want us to take this video real quick. It's your clip.
Why, when things seem to go well, suddenly, without warning, they stop working? Questions. Questions that rarely have answers. And all they do is increase the uncertainty. How much does luck have to do in all this? But actually, in a second, everything can change. Is it true when they say that if a door is closed, a window opens? Life, at times, seems to be driving itself. It turns, changes pace. How much do we really influence those changes?
So, as you see this video real quick, right? For those people who do not believe in God's sovereignty, every day they're juggling the balls, right? Juggling their life with this word luck or faith, right? So every day, because simple, they don't believe that God's in this world's working through God's sovereignty. So they're just going through all sort of questions and thoughts, and they lost and pick it up, right? Sometimes they have creativity by, you know, using a lot of worldly methods. But one time, everything, all the creativity, all the power is gone. So they just feel like they're just losing their life, right? These are the something that world people in the world is going through. And we as a people who accepting God's sovereignty, and this is my point, it's an important point, is we as children of God, we must ensure the God's territory. Right, we must truly help the people, right, who's struggling and who's really lost with this question, and we have to continuously have the conviction and faith to unite together, right? That God is our God, God is our Savior, who will always protect us. So those questions I want you to ask, right? Every day in our life, if something goes wrong, something goes bad, right, you kind of blame yourself, or you are trying to figure out the, you know, reason from your outer situation and things like that, and you are trying to look for the motivation and power from outer source, right? If you're continuously doing that, I want you to ask yourself, who am I, right? Who am I? Am I the child of God who believes in God's absolute sovereignty to truly realize that this world has to, everything needs to begin from Him and through Him, right? Or do I really confess like David every morning in my life, right? That's something that I want us to think about it. So in order for us to accept God's absolute sovereignty, understanding there's a call for our faith, we have to restore our faith first, right? That is something called what we call restoration of faith, and it comes from we accept that accept the biblical inerrancy, right? Absolute, there is absolute truth in the Bible. And actually, this week I debate with my friend who is in dentistry school, who's receiving like higher education. Like, he studied a lot of biology and all this. And it's like, hey, man, I know you're my friend, I respect you, but do you really believe that God created us from the dust, right? And he's like, no, I believe that we are evolved from, you know, like organism, like the species, like monkeys, right? And while we were just keep debating it, right? It's through the debate, right? All I can tell him is it's not about I'm right or he's wrong, right? Or he's right and I'm wrong. I could only tell him the only evidence I have is, you know, I have this Bible and I believe that this Bible is truth because every day in my life, this Bible leads my life, right? And every day, the scripture that I read and the message that I listen every Sunday, the worship that I have, right, that words perfectly align with it, so I may not receive like as higher education like you do, and I don't really have this mystery of like biological mystery or how like the cell and transform and evolve and things like that. I may not know this, but I know for sure this God who created this world through his words, always leading me and guiding me, and that's why I'm standing here. And that's something that I have shared. And every day we have unbelief, right? And the guy who I debate with, right, he knows a lot of things, but then sometimes the truth turns around and becomes worry, right? And then that worry leads him to have failure. And because you have to move forward and you're just standing there and just worrying about the things because you have a lot of knowledge and you have learned from the education, the world, right? And the purpose of the education supposed propels you and it's supposed to make you go further more and progress. However, if that knowledge just makes you concern more, makes you worry more, makes you question more, right? And if that leads to failure, right, we know what we need to restore, right? And because of that, right, what happened is a lot of people go into the illness. I met a lot of people yesterday because of the situation that I was in. I was in New York City. I was just constantly meeting people there, like thousands of thousands of people, right? And I'm surprised that everybody's going through some type of illness, either mental problem, either physical problem. They're I don't know what happened through COVID-19, right? People are struggling with having just regular conversation, or either they can't even properly walk, right? They're limping every day, I mean, every single step, right? I was like, wow. I was always surrounded by this healthy people, and I did not know how much blessing we have received every day in our life, right? And this is what people are struggling because of their unbelief, right? So we have to, in order for us to restore faith, we have to truly believe that God is absolute word. And then second, we have to break free from this unbelief today, right? And then we really see God's absolute sovereignty, right? First thing is one of the God's important, accepting one of the important part of God's absolute sovereignty. God's absolute sovereignty is accepting, believing the creation story, right? God created us and there's a providence, right? And there is decree and there's a life and death. Everything is under his sovereignty, right? A lot of times when we live our life and we want to kind of, you know, compromise with word and say, even though you know what God has said us and God established the decree and you know, and things like that, and what we should not do in the providence, in His providence, right? But we try to compromise, Lord, our life, half of our life is in this world, right? Just please, let me just, you know, please bear with me, right? Sometimes we try to make an excuse, right? But how about we try to fully accept God's sovereignty, right? And or sometimes we fear about it, even though we're like, you know, some people ask this question, right? Is it okay as a child of God, like you believe in Jesus Christ and as He, you know, save us from the sin, so you do whatever you want? No, because we believe God. We wouldn't do that in the first place because we believe that God's created us. So therefore, He will end our life at any time, any second. So what? Until the last breath, right? I don't know if I am His child, right? Because I don't know when is my life going to end, right? I want to show the best form, right? Best way, right? Best form of me, right? Instead of some ugly part of me, right? So the next one is history, right? Sometimes we question, right? Through the history, right? There is negative part and positive part. However, right? There is no time that God has abandoned humanity, right? God was always with us, right? And that's the truth. And a lot of times, and if you don't believe that, that leaves future in faith, right? Every day we wonder about what's going to happen, right? Is it God will abandon us through COVID-19? Or God will abandon us through AI age? Right? God will abandon us. And we try to learn more about it instead of focus more about His words, right? So what do we have to do? God always with us through the history. And then that is the perfect way of salvation. And that alone has a God, falls under God's sovereignty, right? This is something that no one can challenge God, right? Even though we, as some individually, you might be talented, you might be so smart, or you might be so great, and do a lot of things, right? There is only way of salvation, that is Jesus Christ. And there's a lot of parts that God wants to tell us, right, about this Jesus Christ. However, there's one thing that I want to focus. According to Numbers chapter 21, verse 9, there was a lot of sin happened in the Israelites, right, during this journey to land of Canaan. It says, so Moses made a bronze snake and put it up on a pole. Then when anyone was bitten by a snake and looked at the bronze snake, they lived. So God sent this snake, poisonous snake, right? However, these people, right, just look up on the staff, right, on this bronze snake, right, that Moses was lifting up. Right, they will live. And this word just fulfilled in John chapter 3, verse 14 through 18. It says, just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through Him. Whoever believes in Him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stand condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. And that's the truth. A lot of people, somehow, some way, they believe that there is a higher spiritual being and divine power. And they try to figure out how to be connected or be united with Him, right? Whether you're effort, or whether your, you know, kindness, or whether serving church religiously, but the Bible simply tells us that you have to look up, you have to lift up, right? This Jesus Christ, name of Jesus Christ, right? In our life, believe in the name of Jesus Christ and accept Jesus Christ and lift up His name. And that's the perfect way and only way to receive salvation. And that's what we need to do as we accept God's absolute sovereignty. All right, so what do we have to do? We have to experience and confirm every day in our life. As we read in the slide, we have to really enjoy the comfortness that God has given us as we listen to the message sermon last week, right? I know that probably you have enjoyed comfortness that God has given us through the week. That's what I believe. Amen? Yeah? You guys enjoyed comfort, true comfortness? Yes. So I really realized that this is the way that enjoying my given authority, right? That's the only way I can enjoy the comfortness, right? Be who I need to be, right? Be the person that I need to. I was created, right? Comfortness is not simply I can explain. This is something that everybody can agree. There's a fish live under the water, right? If I take out the fish. And as we all know, fish must live under the water. But if somebody forcibly take out the fish out of the water, and let's say that like this person was so kind enough to build a five bedroom right mansion, right, to live or have a luxury car, buy the luxury car for fish, right, feed him steak every day. Right? Fish will never be happy, right? Let's think about this. There is a beautiful bird, right? And let's say you're like building huge house for birds, right? To live. Bird will never be happy because why? Bird is created to be fly, right? To fly and to burst the sky, right? And travel with the freedom, right? That's what it was created. So for us, in order for us to be the person, be a human that God want us to be, we have to be with God. And that's the truth. And that's the only way we can enjoy the comfortness. And that is, an authority means we live our life with the five assurances. An assurance of salvation, assurance of forgiveness, assurance of guidance of the Holy Spirit, assurance to answer prayer, assurance of victory. And I believe that through this week, I believe that you all meditate on these five assurances. And one more time, I want you to really captivate this assurance every day in our life. And so that this five assurance can be truly imprinted in my life. So when the tribulation and disaster comes, you know, we can truly overcome with these five assurances. As I said, the peace that God gives can only be truly experienced when we trust in and live by the five assurances of the authority granted to us under God's sovereignty. In our daily lives, and as we engage with the world, we must hold on to these five assurances and enjoy the covenant through worship, right? Whether this open worship, whether Sunday worship, or whether your daily worship, or whether your worship with the family, right? As we acknowledge God's absolute sovereignty and give Him glory, like King David in 1 Chronicles, First Chronicles chapter 29, verse 10 through 14, as we all have confessed together, we are called to live as spiritual summit and skill summit and cultural summit, enjoying the identity God has given us as remnants. So worship is a conclusion. But the question that I want to ask is, how much do we take it seriously about this worship, right? How are we accepting God's sovereignty when we give Him worship today on Sunday. I know there's a lot of things going to happen on Sunday and can happen and may happen during the worship time. You know, your individual worship time is great, but I'm just going to talk about this Sunday worship, right? There's a lot of crazy things may happen. You might think of some school homework assignment, right? You probably receive a call from your loved one that there's conflict in your family. But as a child of God, if you can believe that, you know, God cannot protect me while we're having worship, how are we going to overcome this world, right? When we go out there. So on Sunday, when we call it Lord's Day, how much do I really give my hearts and give my life to God? How much do I prepare for my life for this serving God, right? And that's just simply is a way for us to enjoying or accepting God's absolute sovereignty and practice accepting God's absolute sovereignty. So today, when we are having worship, or when we came to worship, right? I want to fully engage in worship, whether it's a praise, prayer, and you know, listening to message. I want us to be the summit. Summit that no one can touch you, no one can bother you, no one can hinder you, because you're on top of it, right? You're in the peak. You're in the place where God is. God has established you, right? So let us truly enjoy that. It's not something that, you know, I can proudly say that I'm also doing a good job. I'm also saying it to myself that I need to do a better job every day as a student, as a young person, right? So always, as we accept God's sovereignty, one thing we can do is we can truly help one another, help our brothers and sisters together to be engaged and fully accepting God's sovereignty to glorify His name and to have fully enjoyed this wonderful worship that God has given us. So let us pray at this time. Our Father, we love you and thank you so much for this wonderful time, Lord. Lord, every day, and every year, and every age, there's always a difficulty in our life. And that difficulty is nothing special, but the difficulty is the force of darkness that hinders us every day to not able to enjoy this wonderful worship. As we accept God's absolute sovereignty, I know that you always lead us and guide us. And everything comes from you and everything must go through you. As we confess that, allow us truly value this worship as our life, Lord. And as we really enjoy this worship, Lord, allow us to receive the heavenly power so that we can truly be the skill summit, a spiritual summit and cultural summit to change this flow of the world, Lord. We are no longer be the people who will be influenced by this world. We will truly break the unbelief to change and reform this world with your word, Lord. So at this time, please fill us with your Holy Spirit and guide us with your Holy Spirit, Lord. Please break all force of darkness at this time. In Jesus Christ we pray, amen.
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of our Father, and the work of our Holy Spirit be upon all who acknowledge the sovereignty of our Lord and who proclaim this sovereignty in their field from now and forever.